Welcome to the night of 9/11/2015, and if you want entertainment, you've come to the right place, because we are going to weave a number of narratives together here. Okay, now I don't know if it's just this 14th anniversary, double jubilee of 9/11, or is it the ferocious heat spell that we've gone through in California, and maybe I'm suffering from heat exhaustion and it's lowering my defenses and everything is just coming out, you know, free association is just coming out. Somehow it's all fitting together and amazing insights are happening here. Maybe it's a confluence of just everything, okay? But whatever it is, I just like, you know, the clarity is just showing up. I look here, I look there, I look there, I say, oh my gosh, isn't this extraordinary? Isn't this extraordinary? Let's start with something. I'll throw you some unexpected curveball. Jonah, the prophet Jonah in the Bible, you know, that Jesus says that, you know, they ask him for a sign of the end times, and he says, no sign I'll give except for the, you know, the sign, Jonah, the sign of Jonah, sign of the whale, sign of Jonah is known as. And we're wondering, what is that, what is that, what is that? Well, you know, I happen to be digging into something today on the internet, just a little bit, because I have to tell you, a dream that I had, a prophetic dream that I had maybe a decade ago, it's been quite some time. I've been trying to figure it out because I know it's super important, and I'm leaning now towards a certain interpretation involving Iraq, and World War III. And I was looking at this, looked up Iraq, World War III, and somebody said that a Defense Department, somehow Defense Department had leaked a battle plan to take Mosul, should Mosul ever be taken, or something like this. And this was a plan for World War III. There is a plan for World War III. And then I said, wait a minute, didn't I hear that ISIS had taken Mosul? I thought they had. So I looked up Mosul on Wikipedia, and son of a gun, they do occupy Mosul. And this is what the Defense Department paper said, that if Mosul's ever taken, this is a way that there's going to be a battle plan to, you know, for war, World War III, really, to take Mosul back, and it's a big deal. I said, okay, well, and then I was in reading the description of Mosul, I came down and said, the shrine of Jonah the prophet is in Mosul, and I said, wow, okay, and then I said, wait a minute, didn't ISIS blow up the shrine of Jonah just recently? And I remembered I put that in a video, so I said, yeah, that's right, it blew it up. But there's something else that was missing from this entire picture, and this is what I'm going to share with you now. It's that it said that Mosul is on the west bank of the Tigris River, I believe, and on the east bank is the ancient city of Nineveh. And of course, knowing history, well, that's the capital of Neo-Assyrian Empire. I mean, that was built up by one of the kings, Sennacherib or something, and to the, you know, the biggest city in the world at its time. And this was a big deal, Nineveh. It's on the east bank, right across from Mosul. Okay. Now, I was looking at the derivation, that they go into a derivation on Wikipedia about Nineveh, the name Nineveh. Where it comes from, and they seem to come up with saying it has to do with the fish. It's the sign of Nineveh is the sign of a fish. Now Nineveh was a huge city. Jonah said that it took 3 days to walk throughout the breadth of it. Well, they may think that to walk all around it, it took 3 days. Okay, this is very important. So Jonah was in the city of the fish for 3 days. City of Nineveh. City of Nineveh was the city of the fish. They say the goddess of the fish or something. They worship this is where the term came from. And Jonah says it took 3 days to walk throughout the city. And then in the Bible, though, it says Jonah was swallowed up by a big fish for 3 days and stayed in the belly of this fish for 3 days. Hello? Hello? I guess I'm the first one to ever put this together. Hallelujah. What it's talking about is Jonah was in the city of Nineveh, you know, walking throughout for 3 days. It's talking about Jonah going to the city of Nineveh. And Jesus says that we won't, the evil and adulterous generation, which is certainly our generation, the generation in this world right now, the people, no sign will be given of the end times. No sign will be given except the sign of Jonah. Well, the sign of Jonah would have to be in the area of Nineveh, okay, where it happens to be. Mosul has now gone off partly into the East Bank, I believe, and parts of it is now built in the ancient city of Nineveh. And that's where the shrine at Jonah happens to be. And that's where ISIS blew up the sign of Jonah. You talk about a sign of Jonah blowing up the shrine to Jonah and the city of the fish. This is very, very potent. You see, obviously, you know, this the idea of Jonah, you know, he was fleeing Nineveh because he didn't tell the Ninevites to repent as the Lord had told them to. And on that way of fleeing, you know, he's supposed to fell off a ship and was swallowed up by a great fish and lived in the belly of the fish for 3 days. Obviously, this is nonsense. Okay. It's not literal at all. And the 3 days that he spent circumnavigating Nineveh, traveling the breadth of it, and they think that had to do with going to different quarters, the four quarters of Nineveh. Okay, put it together. The city of the fish, the great city, the greatest city in the world, the great fish. 3 days in the great fish. Okay. Then he finally went back and told them to, look, you have to repent, otherwise you're going to be destroyed. And they then started fasting and repenting of their wickedness, and they were spared. And Jonah criticized God for that, saying, why did you do that? And God says, well, you know, why should I strike those who are so ignorant they can't tell their right hand from their left? And I want to spare the animals too, so I decided to spare Nineveh. Okay, whatever. But we now see that the biblical story of Jonah was very likely talking about Jonah's time in Nineveh and Jonah's commitment to that city of Nineveh. The two are inextricably bound together, Jonah and the city of Nineveh. What happened to the city of Nineveh? Well, like I said, Mosul is now, you know, incorporated the ancient ruins of Nineveh. There are a lot of suburbs there. That whole area could be called, you know, could be referred to, the ancients would call it the city of Nineveh. ISIS has taken that over. It's a very extremely strategic city in Iraq, and they blew up the shrine where Jonah is buried. They blew it up. Demolition. Now, if this isn't a sign, you know, sign of Jonah, I don't know what is. It's just an extremely direct connection. Now, that dream that I had about what I felt was, there's three distinct phases to this dream. And recently I connected the idea of rocks. A rock fell on top of my car. A rock. And I said, wait a minute. I always said Iraq. So but a lot of people say Iraq. You know, yeah. It's Iran, Iraq. A rock. Okay. In this dream, I was in the desert. I was in the desert. Well, where is Iraq? It's pretty much in the desert, right? I mean, it's a dry place there, except for the rivers going through. And there was this highway going along, the highway 111 was the name of the highway. Well, I didn't put this together until just right now. The highway. What happens when war happens? You get distracted from the highway of spiritual truth. You get pulled into the blame game. The highway is to recognize everything as a dance of continuity fear. And there's no one particular to blame at all. It's just the continuity fear that's doing all of this. And what I saw this mountain right above the highway. And I looked, and suddenly I saw the side of the mountain, some rocks there, a group of rocks, let's say, suddenly collapsed and rolled out over the highway a little bit. These boulders rolled out like a landslide. But it wasn't so bad. We were able to recover from that pretty quickly. I said, oh, okay, that wasn't so terrible. I thought it might be a big problem. It wasn't so bad. Then a little later, a second area, a rock outcropping, I might say, collapsed. And this also rolled over this highway. And this was worse. This was worse. But we finally recovered from that too. Okay. Now let me take you through this dream, because I believe I've really nailed it finally. I've been trying so hard for all these years to figure this out. The first landslide outcropping of a rock outcropping was Iraq's invasion of Kuwait, right? Iraq went into Kuwait and a desert storm happened during the presidency of the first Bush. And that was cleaned up pretty quickly, right? I mean, big show of force, the Iraqi army just collapsed and they fled and, you know, they burned the oil wells. But it wasn't such a big deal. Exactly like in the dream. We worried, oh, this might be the big deal. It wasn't. Same thing in the dream. I thought, oh my gosh, this landslide could be really terrible. And we say, oh, it's not so bad at all. Actually, we cleaned up for it and it's okay. So this is how we, you know, that's the end of that first Iraqi war. The second Iraqi war was, of course, when the United States and its allies went after Saddam Hussein, quote, supposedly for weapons of mass destruction. But we know that was a pretext. And that was a lot worse. That war was a lot worse, wasn't it? Because it actually then morphed in the war in Afghanistan. And just like in the dream, the second collapse of a rock collapsing, so to speak, and fragmenting. All right, this is what happened in the dream. This was a lot worse, and it lasted a long time, and yet we were able to recover from that, and now, you know, we feel like we're finally, you know, we went out of Iraq, we're pretty much out of Afghanistan. We feel like, you know, okay, just like in the dream, the feeling. Now, we get to the third situation, and the third situation, the entire rock, this mountain was made of rock. And it could stand for a rock, a huge rock, a big rock, a rock. The entire side of the mountain collapsed, all the rock, and it fragmented in so many big boulders that it absolutely buried the highway and roared through a huge area, and it was, I had to flee from this for my life. It was so terrible. It was astonishingly how terrible it was. Buried the highway. You see what the dream? The dream was so intelligent that I couldn't figure it out. Sometimes dreams are too smart for us, you know. Usually they are. It was so clever by using the rock to symbolize a rock, you know, in the dream. And I just didn't get it until I think yesterday. And now I'm putting it all together. And the next situation in Iraq is going to be absolutely terrible. Now, we see that ISIS has gone in there and it has been spreading this horrible distraction of its atrocities through the media for quite some time now. Now, this is being extremely distracting for people, actually. They don't realize it. I've just ignored it. I haven't seen it. I haven't watched a single video about all the atrocities or what ISIS is doing at all. Completely said, no, I'm not going to pay any attention to this. Okay, so it hasn't distracted me. But I can guarantee you that it has distracted the world very severely. But this is just likely the precursor. Because the sign of Jonah, blowing up the shrine of Jonah in Nineveh. Okay. It has to be what Jesus is talking about, that sign. And we've had other signs now that talk about the coming end times. In the dream, the collapse, the whole side of the mountain collapsed. It was a massive collapse. Well, we've seen that area in the world have a massive collapse with ISIS, but I feel the size of the collapse was way more massive than ISIS can account for. And in that DOD, Department of Defense paper, it talks about how, or the commentary on it, it talks about how ISIS wants to get in a war with the West. That's what they want. And they want to pull us into a war there. And we know, of course, that from those who are studied the Bible, for instance, they talk about a great final war in the Middle East, right? And by the way, thanks to one of our great viewers who pointed out today in Israel, massive sandstorm on 9/11, the 14th anniversary double jubilee. There's this worst sandstorm in the history of the new state of Israel, 75 years. It's that, and it's coming from Syria. And interestingly enough, Yahoo on their mail page has this photograph with these very dark brown clouds, very similar to the sandstorm that's taking place in the Middle East right now. It's a very bad omen, actually, for have it on this day. It correlates exactly with what I saw in the dream in the third collapse of Iraq, of the rocks collapsing, that the dust was so bad. The result was everywhere was choked with dust, and nobody could they were alive, but they couldn't function. The dust was everywhere. It was just a massive dust storm. The turmoil from the collapse of all these rocks was so extreme that people were just huddling in their homes, extremely confused, that we can't function, we can't go anywhere, this is horrible. I mean, it was a super traumatic dream, and I knew it was a very prophetic dream of what is to come. And I ended up going like 100 miles an hour, fleeing in a vehicle to the next state over, which in the dream, the dream seemed to be set in a desert in California, so I went to Arizona. I don't know if that has any special significance other than the next state. So I was able to get into the next state, and there I told them, hey, I have to take asylum here. You know, the situation back there is so terrible. And they said, yeah, we understand entirely. We understand what's going on there. And absolutely, we're prepared for asylum seekers to come here, refugees to come here. And I was welcomed there and told, you know, just, you know, this our place is your place. And it was a way, way better place than this world, actually. Way better. So all this stuff is starting to tie in together right now, isn't it? And as I pointed out before, not standing in judgment of people at all, but just interpreting biblical prophecy clearly. In the Bible, they talk about sodomy as the abomination. It's abomination, and it's the abomination that makes death desolate, meaning it doesn't produce any offspring. Okay, so the ancient peoples, that's how they saw it. It's an abomination because it's against nature, doesn't produce offspring, which is the most all important. They viewed the marriage as holy matrimony. It's called holy matrimony. It's not called marriage. It's called holy matrimony. And the idea is because it produces, quote unquote, bodies, but it produces life, as they interpret it, produces life. And whereas sodomy does not produce any life, you see, it's sterile in that way. So they call it the abomination that maketh desolate, that maketh desolate, brings about desolation. No, desolate means no life coming from, no life is there, no life is present. So what they said, the prophecy is, when you see the abomination that maketh desolate, which would be sodomy, standing in the holy place where it ought not be. Now, the holy place, ancients were talking about, is holy matrimony. Holy matrimony. And when it has standing in the place, the holy place where it ought not be, what it means is it's elevated, it's standing, its legal standing is equal now to holy matrimony. That's what it means in standing in the holy place where it ought not be. It means, so the gay marriage is what they make the abomination that makes desolate, standing in the holy place where it ought not be. I mean, it's being made same stat legal status as holy matrimony. Then know that the, you know, destruction is near, the end times is near, the terrible tribulation is near, and flee to the hills of Judea, flee to the hills. In other words, flee. So we have both these events. I'm not sure when they blew up the shrine of Jonah. And gay marriage was made, what was it, June 26 or something? I wonder if blowing up Jonah was a similar date. Maybe I can even look, and you can even look too. I don't know if this is going to interfere with the video or not, but this is pretty interesting. Because we have a tremendous confluence of prophecy taking place in the world right now. And that dream I had, it seems to be now, as I finally interpreted the highway, it's highway 111, 111, but actually it means oneness, oneness, oneness. It's emphasizing oneness, which is the highway, okay, which is the vision of oneness. In other words, our purpose as spirit pretending to be human is to set down that pretense and realize the true oneness that we are. And so the highway is oneness, 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 which is emphasized, and that is the highway that was buried by the collapse of this huge rock, a big rock. So if you'll just bear with me right for a moment here and just sort of start feeling this, you know, and say, hey, this is very interesting. I'm going to see what date that they blew up the Shrine of Jonah. This is pretty interesting. Shrine of Jonah blown up. I bet you it was in a similar, you know, it was a similar time frame. I know it was this year, wasn't it? So these things are happening, like, right cluster of all this stuff happening right together. And I'm getting very, very intense pressure from the Holy Spirit, or you know, inspiration. Let's see. Oh my gosh. Yeah, it is similar. It's similar. It's a little bit later. It looks like July 24th. July 24th. So it's right. It's like within about a month period here. You see the two of these prophetic indications took place. Now, I want to tell you something else. I was woken up early this morning by a phone call, cell phone, and I said, who the heck is calling me now, you know? And I said, hello, and someone said, da 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 da, and I said, what? And again, they said, da 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 da. Well, they were speaking in Vietnamese. Vietnam. People from Vietnam were calling me. Now, I can tell you that this has never happened in my life. Nobody from Vietnam, speaking in Vietnamese, has ever called me in my life. Now, for me, what does that symbolize? Well, immediately I said it symbolizes war. A very nasty war. A long-term nasty war, because I grew up in, of course, the Cold War and then the Vietnam War era. Okay. Now, I don't know, Vietnam War. I probably, you know, when the U.S. started getting involved, was probably I think it was 1965 or so when the United States, but it lasted, well, 1954 through 75 was the entire war. So that's a 21-year war. Okay, the Vietnamese War was a 21-year long war, because of course the French started it, right? I mean, it was started there, and then Americans got pulled into it. So we're talking about a very long war, a very long war. And that war was hell for the United States, I am telling you. Having lived through that, and I know all about it, grew up during that era where, you know, I was worried about being drafted. And fortunately, the draft was ended just prior to, you know, my age, coming of age, so I did not go through the lottery, which they had. We were preparing to flee to Canada, actually. And it was just a horrible thing. I mean, just imagine you come out of high school or something in a nice little town, and you go to the draft board, you've been inducted, you sent to basic training, and then you're whisked off to the jungle of Vietnam. You know, I mean, this is what happened. So when I get a call from someone speaking Vietnamese, well, here we go. That's what I thought, 1964. And combat units were deployed beginning in 1965. So, what are we at now? The 50 years since then? 50 years since then. Since the U.S. first got involved in Vietnam. So we have this 50, and the resonance is just amazing. Because what the Gulf of Tonkin incident, which is what started the situation, which we now know to be a false flag, by the way. We now know it's, well, we've known it for a long time. Gulf of Tonkin incident was supposedly Vietnamese fired on a naval ship in the Gulf of Tonkin, and this was a pretext then for the U.S. to get combat troops over there. But actually, it was a false flag that was a lie. It was a deception that the press reported as if it had happened, and they were probably in cahoots with the military and the whole false flag situation. It was a lie. So I get a call from a Vietnamese. This morning, on the morning of 9/11, 2/15, 50 years after the deployment of U.S. troops in Vietnam, a 21-year war starting in 54, or was it four? Maybe it was. Let me see. Yeah, 54, 21 years old. 21 years old. Well, let's say 20 years old. November to April 75. Okay, 55 to 75. That was a long war there. It was the first Indochina War was 46 to 54, and then 55 to 75. So that area was a war-torn area for a long, long time. So I get a call from a Vietnamese on the morning of 9/11, 2/15. I say, what in the world is this? Wow. And I got it right away. This means a very long, protracted, and terrible war. It's coming. And so all of this is a constellation, you see, of factors now. It's not like just one thing. I'm just sort of putting all the pieces of a puzzle together here. And the way the puzzle is filling out, you know, you look at it and say, wow. Now, I'm going to throw another curveball at everyone. Comcast, we have problems, telephones. A Comcast guy came out, fixed one phone. The other two don't work. Another guy, Comcast guy comes out, fixed this phone. Now they're having problems, our fax line doesn't work. You know, I was just like, you know, I was so upset. I probably have heat exhaustion from the week and everything and fast and diet and everything. But I said, I'm so upset with technology. I just hate it. I absolutely hate it. But yet, what came up for me was, since I had made this deal with my continuity fear in the forms that it's taken, honoring my creativity, I feel that I'm having this fundamental breakthrough. And I said, no, I don't so much hate it. But what it is I deserve better. We all deserve better. In fact, we deserve infinitely better than what technology has to offer us. Technology is the Stone Age. I call it the new stone, the Gilded Stone Age. And I said, you know, this is ridiculous. We are spirit. We deserve infinitely better than this junk that we call technology. It's just absolutely ridiculous. So this is how I feel about it. I wouldn't be the slightest bit bothered if I never see any technology ever again. It's like would we be sad about leaving the Stone Age behind? Yeah, probably not. It is a ridiculously gaudy Stone Age. We have spiritual technology called spirit affirmations, right affirmations, right? You know, I am now, I am now, I am now. You know, we have something so much better that brings us back to what we really are, just spirit. That this technology is just an absurdity, really, an absurdity. And of course, you know, the man, we're supposed to fix everything or something goes wrong. Well, hey, how come the technology things aren't working? You got to fix it. I don't want to spend my time struggling with this stupid technology. It's utterly absurd. It's such a waste of my time. I'm fed up with it. Now, but here's a really weird thing. No teachers, no spiritual teacher that I've ever heard of has ever said anything really about technology at all. Completely mute on the subject, which I find to be absolutely bizarre. Because this planet is being completely overrun and controlled by artificial intelligence. This is the biggest issue. It is a monumental issue because it again threatens the highway so severely. It's an extreme distraction. And to say absolutely nothing about this, I cannot explain to you why that is, unless they do have a response to it. But their response is much vaster and greater than we realize, and that's why they haven't told us about it yet. Other than that, if that's not the case, then they're completely derelict. You know, and how can we say that they're completely derelict? I cannot put this equation together. Is Jesus completely derelict? He hasn't said anything about it. He hasn't said a word about it. And the spiritual teachers in this world, have they said anything about it? And most of them are kind of like, you know, so I think some are thinking, oh yeah, it's that's great, you know, maybe. And as soon as they say that, I said, okay, you know, later with you, you know. It's ridiculous. We deserve infinitely better than technology has to offer us. It shouldn't even be a faint thought in our minds at all, actually. It's a joke. It's a bad, bad joke. And living here in Silicon Valley my whole life and knowing that this is what it all came about, and these people, you know, that brought it all about, you know, we think, oh, they're so great. I mean, these people are idiot savants. They're morons. I mean, they don't know anything about spiritual truth. I mean, the idea of somehow that we're supposed to live in a future of their designing is completely absurd. I tell you, this is utterly absurd. Farcically, whimsically absurd. I mean, I've worked for some of these people that are high placed in they're spiritual morons, okay? The idea that we're supposed to live in the future is supposed to be of their designing, is just a hilarious joke. So, what is the deal? What is going on? Why have we not heard anything? Am I the only one who's going to speak out about this? It seems like, you know, it's just amazing. But there is one option. There is one option, and that is the great, you know, spiritual awareness is very much aware of how terrible this is, what a trap it is, what a distraction it is. And it does have a response, but the response is not just to say, well, it's not so good, I don't like it, you know what? It's got a way bigger response than that. How about it has a response where we get to dwell somewhere else other than this wretched place? You know, how about that as a response? You know, Spirit does things in big ways, really big ways. And that could very well be what is going to take place, what will take place. Because basically it's true that the world has been completely overrun by artificial intelligence, and there's, as far as turning back the clock here in this world, it's not possible. It is absolutely not possible. So they didn't even broach the subject, because we would have thought then we need to oppose it and try to defeat technology in this world, and we would have wasted our time on that. It's not possible in this world. This is what this world has given over into the consciousness now. So it would have been like tilting at windmills, so they didn't say anything about that, so that we wouldn't waste our time trying to do that. That doesn't mean that they don't have a remedy for it. That doesn't mean that they think, oh yes, this technology is a wonderful thing for you, you know, not at all. They just didn't want us to waste our time fighting against City Hall when we knew that, you know, we wouldn't get anywhere. Instead, that doesn't mean they didn't have any response to it. They may have an entire another realm for us to go into, an entire another realm where there's no need for this stupid technology at all. It's a vastly better situation. So you see the wisdom. There is a wisdom there. If Jesus would have said, hey, you know, this, all this stuff, you know, this is terrible for you, very bad spiritually, it's a spiritual darkness on the planet, you know, I would have spent my time fighting against it then and then not getting anywhere, you know, and being crushed and all this stuff and wasting my time. So I didn't say anything about it. But the Holy Spirit has certainly made it clear to me, you know, that avoiding our artificial intelligence is essential. And this narrative of artificial intelligence goes in a hideous, hideous, hideous direction. So inwardly it's saying, yeah, but I say, yeah, but what do we do about it here? Not a word, not a peep. What do we do about it here? Not one word have I ever heard from any spiritual teacher or even the Holy Spirit of what are we supposed to do about it here? And I said, well, if you're not giving us any advice of what we do about it here, then you're just asking us to just, you know, no recourse, but just to dwell in this hellish artificial intelligence place, and we're stuck here. So what good are you? What good are you then? I mean, this is ridiculous. You know, what good is all this spiritual talk if we have to dwell in this cesspool of artificial intelligence and technology? It doesn't make any sense at all, does it? It's kind of like someone like in your deep dark prison, the whole dark black hole of Calcutta, it is hideous, you know. You're suffering so terrible, and someone says, hey, you know what, it's really terrible in there, you know, awful conditions, right? Yeah, you shouldn't be subjected to these conditions, this is really terrible, you know. And you say, yeah, I know, it's, I can't, no food, no drink, it's so hot, I'm dying, it's horrible. Yeah, it's so hot in there, yeah, it's hot, the heat's terrible, isn't it? Someone's yelling into you through the windows or something. And then you scream out, yeah, what do I do about it? And they say, well, I don't know, you know, I don't know. Yeah, it's, Is that the Holy Spirit? Like, what do we? Yeah, you said it's terrible, but what do we do, Holy Spirit? And the Holy Spirit, I don't know. It's terrible, though, isn't it? You know, I'm just telling you, it's terrible. Yeah, but what do I do about it? Well, I don't know. I've got no clue. I'm silent. Then what do I do about it? No response. You know, we would look at that as someone just being malicious to us, wouldn't we? Very malicious. So here we have all this clarity about how terrible it is, and yet not a word about what to do about it, except the Holy Spirit has ceaselessly indicated to me the idea of shifting to a different realm. I said, well, that would cure it. Yeah. I mean, so maybe that is the response of spiritual wisdom to this artificial intelligence, is just sidestep it all. Hasta la vista, baby. And doing that at a time when World War III breaks out, this third Iraqi war, which is, in my dream, it was going to dwarf the other ones. The other ones are like nothing compared to it. Well, you know, the second Iraqi war was pretty terrible, but in my dream, the third one was just unbelievably terrible. That it was so bad, it just buried the highway completely. Meaning people were so confused and distracted by it, they couldn't focus on spiritual truth at all. This is what it means. That's how terrible it was. So, we have the Soviet Union becoming extremely militaristic again. And we have China being extremely militaristic. We have Pakistan. We have India. All right, and United States, and Europe, and you know, you start adding things in the Middle East, all those Middle Eastern states, and you start, you know, adding it all up, and this is the place where all the oil is, you see. And if we went in there and captured all the oil fields, you know, to try to get rid of ISIS, etc., what do you think would happen? What do you think Russia might do? You see, they really want us, the United States, to have control of all that oil? So Russia has seized Crimea, which gives them access to the Black Sea, which gives them theoretical access to, you know, this area. You know, if we look at the Black Sea. Let me take a look here. But they've recently made an agreement with Greece to use some of their harbors. So you see, the Black Sea goes through the Bosphorus Straits. Well, actually, yeah, I'm looking at it right now, the Black Sea. Let me click on this graphic here. Just bear with me here and just take a little breather. As this tries to load, this map only loaded halfway. That's pretty weird. Okay, there it goes now. So they're able to go through Georgia, Russia. Of course, Russia's already, but they will be able to land in Turkey also. Very interesting. However, if they went through, into the Sea of Marmara, through the Straits of Bosphorus, which is where Istanbul is now, then they could go out into the Aegean Sea and use the ports in Greece, then to directly go straight over to Syria through the Mediterranean Sea. So Russia has access to this battleground right now because of they, the ports of Crimea are apparently very, very important to them. Even though Russia does have land fronting on the Black Sea and Sochi and those other places, maybe that militarily those are not strategic, because I know that Crimea is very, very strategic, okay? So you can see how Russia is taking a very strategic approach to the Middle East right now. Of course, they back Assad in Syria. So, we have the makings. Obviously, we have the makings of a potential disaster in the Middle East. And the signs, certainly the dream I had, and the various signs, we had sign of Jonah, abomination of desolation, standing in the holy place where it ought not be. Standing in the holy place where it ought not be, meaning given the same level legal standing as holy matrimony, those are signs. That doesn't mean if someone reads the signs that they're anti-gay or anything like that. It's not true. It is simply these are prophetic signs we've been given to look at to indicate when World War III may break out. And it seems like it's very imminent. I mean, blowing up the Shrine of Jonah was what, July 24th? Gay marriage was June, I believe it was June 26, right? Get the call, Vietnam, tie into Vietnam War, where it started out, where we put combat troops in, and then it started, more and more and more, and before you know it, we were so sucked in and pulled in, it was just horrible. Absolutely horrible. So it talks about a war where you get sucked into it more and more and more and more and more. It helps that first you start out as advisors. This is how we advisors to the French, and then advisors to the South Vietnamese, and then eventually in 65 combat troops after the Gulf of Tonkin, you see. So you start out as advisors. We have advisors in Iraq right now. I mean, right? And the next step may be, some combat troops in there. And, so, and it talks about getting sucked into a severe conflict, Vietnamese War. Well, this is what it looks like is taking place there. So we could go on and on and on about these various very strong indicators. But the strongest indicator is the Holy Spirit itself, which is, it seems to be in a extreme state of urgency, counseling urgency to me. Oh, well, here's a great example happened today. There's so much happening, I can hardly keep it all straight, but this is an extraordinary situation. I happened to be in a situation today where a certain issue came up, and people I didn't know before, but I just met, and I'm just talking with them. Well, it turns out, make a long story short, that they have all these CDs of music in the 60s, all this great music, just tons of them, tons of them. They're doing some archiving project or something. And they have all these extra ones. They said, "We don't know what to do with these. Would you want them? Would you want them? Would you like to take them? Please take them." I mean, they're offering me free CDs with massive amounts of like the best music ever, just that era, the late 50s, 60s, early 70s. I mean, it was unbelievable, really. And I said, "No, no, I got YouTube. I can hear anything I want to whenever I want to." But something told me say no. And then I thought, well, maybe I should go in and talk with them and look what they had. And then something the Holy Spirit said, "No, you don't have the time." And And it was an amazing thing, because I asked them about it, because I heard this song playing in the house, and it was got no time for you. I got no time. This is a song in the 60s. I can't remember who did this, a Moby Grape, or you know, we could look it up too, as we're just kind of hanging out here. Anyway, that was the song that was playing. I heard this song playing. I said, wait a minute. I know that song. That's the 60s. Listen to 60s music. They said, yeah, you know, doing this great archive project. And you want all these CDs? And I turned them down. I turned it down. And I thought that was absolutely extraordinary. Because for me to turn down that kind of offer, this is astonishing. Got no time song. Song lyrics, let me see. The Guess Who, of course, the Guess Who. I think that's a Canadian group, right? On my way to better things, no time left for you, I found myself some wings. Oh, listen to this. Oh, this is incredible. On my way to better things, no time left for you, I found myself some wings, no time left for you. Distant roads are calling me, no time left for you. Oh my God, this is just unbelievable. This is just amazing. So I'm working at this place. I hear this song coming out of a house, and then I later see somebody who lives in the house, and I say, hey, you're listening to 60s music. What's going on? And the song was No Time by the Guess Who. And these are the lyrics. And I felt like I had no time to accept all these CDs. I said, I don't have any time for it. I gotta go. Now, for me, being one of the great musical nuts addicts of all time, for me to turn that down, you know, nobody would ever thought that's possible. Free. I mean, I don't know. They'd maybe talking about hundreds and hundreds of CDs with, you know, just full of all this great music, free, just given to me right now. But I said, I don't have time for this. I don't have time. Got no time for this. This is the kind of urgency that the Holy Spirit is impressing upon me right now. Everything I do is says, no, don't be distracted by this. You got no time for that. Go, 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 go. I said, what in the heck's going on, Holy Spirit? I mean, you know, what's the rush? So let's hear these lyrics again. On my way to better things, no time left for you. I found myself some wings, no time left for you. Distant roads are calling me, no time left for you. And then it goes on, no time for a summer friend. Wow. No time for the love you send. Seasons change and so did I. You need not wonder why. You need not wonder why. There's no time left for you. No time left for you. On my way to better things, no time left for you. I found myself some wings. No time left for you. Distant roads are calling me. No time left for you. No time for a gentle rain. No time for my watch and chain. No time for revolving doors. No time for the killing floor. Wow. No time for the killing floor. There's no time left for you. No time left for you. No time for a summer friend. No time for the love you send. Seasons change and so did I. Okay. And it goes on, you know. Okay, you need full lyrics on Google Play. What in the world is that? You get the picture? This is like the most awesome song possible to describe these times. The most awesome song possible. I mean, it's just like literally describing these times. And here I hear this song playing, and it, you know, someone's archiving it. This is the song that's playing. And they say, do you want? And I say, I got no time for it. Well, you know, you can't make this up. It's beyond what you can even, you know, even think about. No time left for you, no time left for you. And it just goes, got no time, no, 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 no time, no, 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 no time. I got no time. No, 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 no time. I got no time, time, no time, time, got no time. So that's how it ends. That's how it ends, yeah. Oh, he says, you need not wonder why, you need not wonder why. There's no time left for you, no time left for you. So you need not wonder why, don't wonder why. So the Holy Spirit's saying, you know, don't spend your time wondering why. So this is a song that happens to give me, and I reject this incredible offer that just dropped right in my lap. I reject it. And this created an astonishment in my entire psyche. Knowing my history, my musical history, you know, to reject this is just astonishing. My God, I could have had a whole library of these awesome CDs with all this great music on it. As I've said, my previous life was Johannes Brahms, and I had this incredible musical library of all these manuscripts. I collected manuscripts, and you know, I had one of the best collections in the world, really. It was just an incredibly awesome collection. So in this life, I've collected music, albums, CDs. I mean, I had massive amounts of music. And the idea of suddenly being presented with just this whole archive of music, free. Hey, take them. We got no room for them. It's, you know, we don't have to do with them. They're extras. And I said, no. I said, no. Can you imagine that? I said, no. This should give you an indication of how extreme the situation is, and how greatly I have changed, and how greatly I understand that the highway of spiritual understanding of the continuity of fear and that I am now is all important. It's infinitely more important than music, okay? It's infinitely more important than music. And we don't got time to sit around listening to music right now. So I flat out turned it down. I think it kind of shocked them. They said, oh, are you interested in music too? I said, yeah, I guess you might say that. You might say, but I actually said, I know all those songs. I sang them all. I played them. I know every, you know, I know all the songs from the 60s and, you know, whatever, you know, it goes on and on. I mean, my gosh. Here's another thing. Here's another thing that's quite astonishing. And I just told you this would be a very entertaining video. And so far, it's delivered on that promise. Last night, the Holy Spirit says, hey, listen to this. I start singing, hey, I live on the 99th block floor in my block. I said, wait a minute, that's Get Off of My Cloud. What are the lyrics? What are the lyrics? I start singing this song, Get Off of My Cloud by the Rolling Stones. It was back, was it 65 or something? They put that 64, 65. All right, it's around there, mid-60s. And it's a great song. And I couldn't quite get the lyrics to it. I said, what are the lyrics? I live on the block of the, I live on the third floor of the 99th flat of my block or something. I said, no, let me check out. So I actually went to YouTube and got the song with the lyrics on it. And boy, was I surprised. Shocked. That all the lyrics in the world, I would go have gone to this one right now. Listen to this. It says, I live on the 99th floor. I said, no, I live in an apartment on the 99th floor of my block. Okay, so far. So I live in an apartment on the 99th floor of my block. I said, okay, I got that right now. And I sit at home looking out the window, imagining what? I always thought it was. I sit at home looking out my window, imagining the world after dark. The world after dark. That's what I always thought it had said for 50 years. That's what I thought the lyrics said there. But it's not. It's that I sit at home looking out my window imagining the world has stopped. The world has stopped. So I live in an apartment on the 99th floor of my block. Boom, 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 boom. And I sit at home looking out the window, imagining the world has stopped. You know, what? This is the lyrics the Holy Spirit told me to look at? Imagining the world has stopped? And of course it goes on. And in flies a guy all dressed up in a Union Jack. And he says, hey, I would have won 5 pounds if I had his kind of detergent pack. You know, which is just a, you know, typical, you know, Stones lyric. Actually, their lyrics were quite good, interesting. Not that they really meant anything. None of the, you know, most lyrics don't mean anything, to tell you the truth. Some do. I mean, there's some prophetic lyrics here and there. But most of the lyrics really, you know, the Beatles are all about, she loves you, yeah, 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 you love you, yeah. With a love like that, you know, you should be glad. You think you lost your love, well, saw her yesterday, hey. You know, she's thinking of, and she told me what to say, hey. She said she loves you, and you know that can't be bad. You know, it's all about young love, adolescent love. That's what the Beatles are about for a long time. And then they tried to get heavy, you know, but they took a bunch of drugs because they said, you know, we got to try to get profound here. But it was just a bunch of drugged out nonsense, really, their lyrics. But The Stones are different. I mean, the Stones are sort of the option to the Beatles of the time. They kind of had a harder edge to them. It wasn't so much about adolescent love, really, so much, the Stones. And anyway, then I went, of course, time is on my side. Well, I don't know about that. But here we go. I'm sitting at home, looking out my window, imagining the world has stopped. Stop the world, I want to get off. Wow. So when I heard that lyric, this sent shockwaves through me. Out of all the lyrics, I've directed that one, and I had got it wrong this entire time, and finally was clarified for me. It meant imagine the world has stopped. And of course, the name of the group, the Rolling Stones. And the dream, what was the dream about? Rolling Stones. All these rocks. A rock collapse. A collapse of a rock face. A rock wall. The collapse of a rock wall. A rock wall going into all these rolling stones, these boulders, these rolling stones. And of course, another song the Holy Spirit directed me just recently, also a couple days ago, is Gimme Shelter by the Rolling Stones, which is one of the great songs of the 60s, actually. The Stones, the early Stones were great, you know, I mean, it's just awesome music. Then things got crazy at Altamont in 1969. And since that time, things have gotten really, really weird. Not that they weren't weird before, but they started to get really weird. And a lot of bad stuff happened in 69, towards the end of 69, which collapsed the 60s. That was the end of the peace and love generation. Unfortunately. But, of course, the Vietnam War was going on then terribly, too. So it was a very stressful time. But Gimme Shelter. And also another song the Holy Spirit directed me to. I said, why am I listening to Stones? I haven't listened to them in ages. You can't always get what you want. Right? You can't. But if you try some time, you just might find you get what you need. Right? Okay. So you can't always get what you want. But if you try, sometimes you just might find you get what you need. So we might be saying, like, this is not working, this web page. We might be saying what we really want is that we want artificial intelligence to just go away. Leave us in peace. We've had enough of you. We can do better than that. We can do way better than that. You can't always get what you want. LYRICS lyrics. Let's see if it'll do something. So what we want, maybe we can't get that, which is this world being the way we want it to be, right? But if you try sometimes, you just might find you get what you need. And what do we need? Maybe we need another realm, right? Maybe that's what we need. And so the Holy Spirit directs me to this song. You can't always get what you want. Lyrics. L-Y-R-I-C-S. Okay. And the lyrics are kind of odd, you know. I mean, I don't know what there is to say in the lyrics, but so these songs, Get Off of My Cloud, Give Me Shelter, You Can't Always Get What You Want. Potent messages for right now. And I was directed, suddenly the song popped into my head. I said, I got to figure out what the lyrics are. Listen, I got to listen to this song. Give me shelter. It's just a shout away. It's just a shout away. I mean, shelter is very close, right? This is the idea, is shelter is really, really close. It's just right there, give me shelter. Well, it's not it's not really responding as typical. Okay. Well, I went down to the Chelsea drugstore. Yeah, I was to have my prescription filled. I was standing there with Mr. Jimny or something. My favorite flavor, cherry red, or I don't know. It's weird lyrics. As a lot of those things were, you know. But they sold the song, you know. Who cares when you're young and the music is bopping and these people are preening and prancing about, and you know they think they're singing about something that's so important. Yeah, I went down to the corner drugstore, and they're just like, yeah, it's cool, it's totally cool, but we didn't know what the lyrics were. Anything is ridiculous. Yep, it's not. It's just not searching right now. The internet doesn't matter. Because we know what we're talking about here. Keeping it entertaining here, keeping it light. You know, we just, this is what we do. You know, this is spirit. This is, spirit is not some sort of brick, you know, ossified brick. It's flexible. It's fluid. It's good humor. It's not stuck. And so the website technology is stuck. I said, well, it's okay, you know. We're moving on and we're fine. Guess what? Guess who? No, guess what? It doesn't. The internet has become unresponsive. It's. Oh, okay. Finally, it flashes. Like I said, imagining the world has stopped. Look out my window. Imagine the world has stopped. Okay, you can't always get what you want. Let me see if I can. It's trying to pull it up. It's super, super slowly. I don't have time for this. Now, let's get into something spiritual as this is trying to load. And that is the practice which I feel is powerful enough to take us into another realm. Okay, and I said I got this out right before 9/11/15 happened. I got this out. This information out. You can't always get what you want. Okay, we're getting there. And I am now. I feel this is powerful enough to actually enable us to somehow enter another realm. This is how powerful it is. And probably more powerful than that. So I want to say something about this practice. I am now. I am now. I am now. Because it's very important. The intellect will make a mistake on this, as it always does. There you go. I got the lyrics now. I'll tell you in a minute. It's a tease here. I better get... Oh, the website might freeze. I better get as many up as possible. Oh, come on. It's behaving erratically, of course. Okay. Oh, boy. It's amazing. They put so many cookies in advertising that you can't even scroll properly anymore on any page you get to. You just can't scroll properly. I am now. I am now. I am now. I am now. Well, let me give you the lyrics before this page freezes up on me. Because it's just jumping all over the place. Not that it's probably important, it's probably just crazy lyrics. Come on, website, get up there. I saw her today at the reception, a glass of wine in her hand. I knew she would meet her connection. At her feet was a footloose man. No, you can't always get what you want. You can't always get what you want. You can't always get what you want. But if you try sometime, you find you get what you need. I saw her today at the reception, a glass of wine in her hand. I know she was going to meet her connection. At her feet was a footloose man. Well, they'd say it over and twice? I don't think so. You can't always get what you want. Can't always get what you want. Can't always get what you want. But if you try sometime, well, you might find you get what you need. And I went down to the demonstration. Huh? Okay, well, I went down to the demonstration to get my fair share of abuse. Yeah. singing, we're going to vent our frustration. If we don't, we're going to blow a 50-amp fuse. Whoa. 50-amp fuse. Has it not been 50 years since combat troops were sent into Vietnam? I didn't know this lyric. It was in here. And I went down to the demonstration to get my fair share of abuse, singing, we're going to vent our frustration. If we don't, we're going to blow a 50-amp fuse. You can't always get what you want. You can't always get what you want. You can't always get what you want. But if you try sometimes, well, you just might find you get what you need. Yeah, yeah. And I went down to the Chelsea drugstore to get your prescription filled. I was standing in line with Mr. Jimmy. And man, did he look pretty ill. We decided that we would have a soda, my favorite flavor, cherry red. I sung my song to Mr. Jimmy. Yeah, and he said one word to me, and that was dead. I said to him, you can't always get what you want. All right, you can't always get what you want. You can't always get what you want. But if you try sometimes, you just might find you get what you need. Yeah, you get what you need. Yeah, oh, baby. Okay, wow. I didn't know this lyric here. Man, 50-amp fuse. I went down to the Chelsea drugstore to get your prescription filled. I was standing in line with Mr. Jimmy, and man, did he look pretty ill. We decided we'd have a soda, my favorite flavor, cherry red. Cherry red. I sang my song to Mr. Jimmy, yeah, and he said one word to me, and that was dead. 50-amp fuse. Vietnam. Call from a Vietnamese this morning. What kind of movie are we in here? I mean, I'm listening to a song, and the guess who? Got no time. You know, got no time. Holy smokes. I saw her today at the reception. In her glass was a bleeding man. She was practiced at the art of deception. Well, I could tell by her blood-stained hands. You can't always get what you want. You can't always get what you want. Can't always get what you want, but if you try sometimes, you just might find you just might find you get what you need. Okay, insanely interesting. What's going on here? Lyrics. Why am I at this site? Let me give me shelter. I don't know the lyrics to that either. So here we are. We want peace in this world. Peace in this world. So that's what we really want. We want peace in this world. He said, you can't always get what you want. Jimmy said, one word, dead. This world, dead. Cherry red, maybe communism, I don't know, or blood. Blood, maybe. But if you try sometime, you just might find you get what you need. Song results, give me shelter. Okay, let's see if I can pull this up. Give me shelter by the Rolling Stones. Just let this sink in. This is like live theater here. I'm just sharing with you what's actually taking place. Keep in mind that we're living in the same world, right? So you're living on a planet right now. I'm living on the same planet here. And this stuff is happening right now. It's happening to me. It could be happening to you. These incidents are taking place right now. And the website is frozen up temporarily, so we'll just let it have its little tantrum here. Waiting for, secure, you know, something, blah, blah, blah. It's always waiting for something, isn't it? Flash talking, you know, secureflashtalking.com. Some flash site that takes forever to load in Google Chrome. You know, we're always waiting here, waiting for technology. Do more waiting for technology than anything. It starts out. Oh, a storm is threatening my very life today. If I don't get some shelter, oh yeah, I'm gonna fade away. War, children, it's just a shot away. It's just a shot away. I didn't know that. That's the lyrics. War, children, it's just a shot away. It's just a shot away. Ooh, see the fire is sweeping. Our very street today burns like a red coal. My God, I didn't know these lyrics. I've never read these lyrics. This is unbelievable. I thought it was a shout away. I guess maybe they say shout. It's a shot away. It says, war, oh, a storm is threatening my very life today. Remember I talked about that storm? I saw a desert storm that was threatening. It was be so severe. I said I had to take shelter from it. I had a dream. I explained this in several videos. And here's this song, Gimme Shelter by the Stone, saying, oh, a storm is threatening my very life today. If I don't get some shelter, oh yeah, I'm gonna fade away. War, children, it's just a shot away. It's just a, okay, now I can find a click. It's just a shot away. It's just a false flag away. This is the Holy Spirit is in a state of extreme urgency, getting my attention onto this. This is just really something. Okay, oh, a storm is threatening my very life today. If I don't get some shelter, oh yeah, I'm going to fade away. War, children, is just a shot away. It's just a shot away. War, children, is just a shot away. It's just a shot away. Oh, see the fire is sweeping. Oh, our very street today burns like a red coal carpet. Mad bull lost your way. War, children, is just a shot away. It's just a shot away. War, children, is just a shot away. It's just a shot away. Rape, murder, it's just a shot away. It's just a shot away. Rape, murder, just a shot away. It's just a shot away. Rape, murder, just a shot away. It's just a shot away. The blood, the floods is threatening my very life today. Give me shelter, give me shelter, or I'm gonna fade away. War, children, is just a shot away. It's just a shot away. War, children, it's just a shot away. It's just a shot away. It's just a shot away. I tell you, love, sister, it's just a kiss away. 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 Kiss away. Kiss away. I had no idea these are the lyrics. I had them completely wrong. I had no idea. Holy smokes. What's taking place in ISIS, the Middle East? Rape, murder, burns like a red coal carpet. I see a fire is sweeping. Man, I had no idea this song was like, was about this. No idea. I couldn't understand the lyrics. I just, yeah, yeah, give me woo, 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 woo. Doom, 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 the way it starts. Holy smokes, these songs by the Rolling Stones are super relevant right now. Get off of my cloud. You can't always get what you want. Give me shelter, give me shelter, give me shelter. And I've been urgently saying, we need to take shelter. There's a coming storm. Now, I told you it was a desert storm. It was a storm in the desert. Well, what was the first war in Iraq called? It was called Desert Storm, wasn't it? Now, I don't know what the details are going to be like there. Sudden collapse. I just, top of my head guessing, I wouldn't put anything past ice. They may detonate a couple of big bombs somewhere or something, you know, as far as I can tell. They want to draw the world into World War III, there's no question about it. And of course, they were the actual troops that we funded and equipped to overthrow Saddam Hussein. Something is very odd going on here, you know. As bad as Saddam Hussein was, he held all the tribal, held all these people together, you know. He held it together. He had to be despotic. Now we see the kind of people we're dealing with. You think Saddam Hussein was out of line by being despotic? I don't think so. Yeah, he was absolutely despotic. But look at the people he was dealing with. Same with Muammar Gaddafi. You know, look at the people he was dealing with. And, you know, there's this destabilization of the Middle East that's taking place intentionally. You know, what was it, the September, this whole democracy, blah, 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 you know, we need to overthrow, you know, Egyptian rule of Mubarak and Gaddafi and Saddam Hussein and now Assad in Syria. What is this this is intentional destabilization, global destabilization leading to World War III. There's no question about it. And the last two presidents have been heavily, the United States have been the ones calling the shots, but who's calling the shots for them? anyway, you know, ISIS could do anything to start a war, or we could do a false flag, and or someone could, and blame it on ISIS to start the world war. And the Holy Spirit is showing me this intense urgency right now. Take refuge. Give me shelter. You got to take refuge right now. And I told you, refuge is in right spiritual practice. And this black and white granite, intrusive, igneous intrusive rock, where it cools slowly inside the earth, so to speak, cools off slowly. Interesting. Might be a situation where we cool off slowly from this world. And black and white is interesting. The neither nor practice, which I've said is the deal we make with, in order to honor our creativity, with all the, all our pretension that we've been pretending not to be spirit, we can give up our pretense, except we honor all the forms that our pretending has taken place, so to speak. They become almost like empty forms. They no longer cause us any fear whatsoever. But somehow, we make a deal with all the creativity that we've made, that will no longer, we'll realize perfectly clearly it's pretense. We'll see that's absolutely, there's nothing but pretense, and we're free of it, peace of mind. And yet we'll still somehow see some representation of the format, which you might say nature, you know, that we use to try and, in our pretending that we're not spirit. And we do this through the neither nor practice. I neither accept you, nature, nor do I reject you. I neither accept you nor do I reject you. Black and white. You see, the combination of granite, black, white, granite, is I neither accept you, like black, you know, I don't accept you, and then white, neither do I reject you. And we can take refuge under this table. I saw a new table, a modern table, with this slab of black and white granite on it. Okay, and I took refuge under it, and I was saved from the desert storm. And just after that, this neither nor practice has come up to the front, and I'm realizing, and I made this deal, and I had this dream of being released as a hostage from the realm of long faces, which is the realm of sadness and depression, and which is the realm of pretense. And I was set free because they trusted me. They said, okay, you've made the correct deal. We accept your deal, and we set you free now. And they really did set me free. It wasn't just a false promise again. They did it. They actually set me free because I used this neither nor practice. Neither do I accept you, nor do I reject you. Extraordinary practice. Black and white practice. You see, this being able to practice this way gives you refuge, gives us refuge from what is coming. Now, I know this is like unbelievably intense and entertaining. And keep in mind that spirit is always genuinely entertaining. You know, just the way that it handles stuff is, it's not all fear bound, is it? You know, this is very fearful stuff we're talking about, but on the other hand, you know, we're joking and making light of this, we're not frozen up in a brick of fear, are we? No, we're not at all, because we have the tools to take refuge. The neither nor, I say this neither nor practice is extraordinarily important. We will not, because of our continuity fear, we will not drop all our pretending as if it never existed and just go on from there. We will not do that. The continuity fear is too extreme. However, we can have that all our pretending reinterpreted to us by the Holy Spirit, will reinterpret it for us. And so before, there's this terrible world of savage, dog eat dog, survival of the fittest, and, you know, hideous, you know, impermanence and stuff. And now the Holy Spirit can show us a world that's just absolutely beautiful. But it's still nature. It's still using the forms that we have dreamed up, that we've been imagining. And we can say, wow, this reminds me, I'm honoring my creativity of this long misadventure I've been engaged in, you know, pretending I'm not what I am. And what a beautiful way to honor my creativity, you know. Because I love my creativity. We love our creativity. No matter what has been engaged in, we love it. And so we want to see some way that we can love it again and say, wow. And yet still, you know, pay tribute to what a tremendous job we did to imagine this realm, this false, imaginary, mirage-like realm of death, of suffering, of impermanence, of vulnerability and all this. What a massive amount of creativity we've used for this, you see. even though it's just a tiny drop in the bucket of our true creativity, which it is just a tiny fragment of a drop of an ocean of our creativity, still, it has a massive amount of creativity in it. So we need to honor this. And so the way to do it is I found out this is what it is. Because I tried this neither nor, and then I had a dream and showing I was released, that, and they accepted this, because which means I accepted it. That's enough. It's enough. I neither accept you, I don't accept the pretense. I neither accept you, but nor do I reject you, meaning, but I honor the creativity involved in this pretense. Okay? This is what it is. Now, I hope there are some that are picking up on this, because it's super important. This dream I have, a coming storm, was pointed out to me, you better take shelter from the storm, or that's it for you. You're going to be terribly distracted. And I took shelter, and it was a modern table. I took shelter on this huge tree, like some sort of gigantic eucalyptus tree or something, but it represented tradition. So I tried to take refuge in the traditional religions, is what I've tried to do, but did not suffice. The storm was too severe for it, and I realized the storm was getting through. And I said, wow, this isn't good enough, what do I do? And suddenly this modern table was placed over me, meaning something we need now in modern times that is better than the tradition. The tradition's not, doesn't give us strong enough protection from this storm. And this neither nor practice now, given right now in modern times by the Holy Spirit, coming from the overall foundation that A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words set, and then my work with the Holy Spirit to clarify and to build upon that. This is what works. Okay, now, getting back to I am now. The intellect will take that as, meaning there's some I that is now, some self that is now. So the I that I am is now. I am now. That's what the intellect will look at it as. This is all wrong. Whereas spirit will say, no. That's not, it's the confusion of words, but that's not what we're saying. I am now, meaning the nowness, is my identity. That is what I am. There's not some other self being in the now. I am the now. The now is literally what I am. Do you get that? It is what I am. It's not that I'm in the now. It's the now is what I am. I am the now. The now is just, the now is the now. That's our identity. That is identity, is the now. The now is. Just the now is. That is all that is the now is. So all is the now. You know, you say all is the now. The now is all. So again, we're not saying that there's some personality that is can abide in the now, right? It's not like that. Or some self is abiding in the now. It's that I am the now. The now is what I am. Not some separate self. No, that the now is the now. That's identity. Now is identity. Now is identity. This is what we're saying when we say I am now. It means now is identity. It now is the one identity. Now is identity. And there is no other identity. So that's another way you could practice it. But spiritually, intuition knows, they'll say, I am now. It understands what we're saying. It's not tricked by the intellect at all. It says, I understand what this is. I am now means the now is what I am. The now is identity. And there is no other identity. The now is the one identity, and there is no other identity. The now is the one identity, and there is no other identity at all. I don't need anything. I am the now. I am the now. That's another way of putting it. I am the now. I am the now. I don't need anything. I am the now. There isn't anything else other than the now, actually. Everything is in the now, right now. It's always has been and always will be. And this is what the realization is all about. And when we're young, we feel this a lot more than when we get older. We sort of get out of touch with this. But we tend to feel it when we're young. We feel that all is the now. And there's only this now. That's it. this is shelter. This is shelter from the storm that's coming. And the urgency that the Holy Spirit has is like this hair's on fire. The hair's on fire, you know. And it's just, I'm just like, go, 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 fast, 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 fast. Get this cleared out. Like I said, I had to clear out, do some clearing out, and the people were going to throw stones. I said, I'll get out of here quickly. And I cleared things out super fast. Got out of there quickly, real fast, double, triple time. My body's kind of aching from that today. So we can move really fast when we need to. And as far as like making graphics, the Holy Spirit said, no, not now. You got to go fast. And what I've been doing, I've been taping, going really, really fast. And if I'd done the graphics, I wouldn't have done that. I wouldn't have got this. I wouldn't have got it. I would have missed it. So the Holy Spirit's right again, you see, right again. I made the great, beautiful graphics. I've done a lot of beautiful graphics. Anyone wants the graphics, they're there. They're there. Not to say I won't ever do them again, whatever, but, you know, who knows what's happening now? It's go time. Now, here's another thing. I told you we're going to just come at it from all angles. Last night I asked the Holy Spirit, show me something that will really help me, because I just don't have a clue right now what to do. And somehow, I got on a Ramana Maharshi, and I got on a blog by David Godman, and they're talking about, I googled Ramana Maharshi's past lives or something. I just popped into my mind, and David Godman wrote an article about this on his blog, and he's sort of what do you call that? English amanuensis of Ramana Maharshi. He's done a great job in sort of bringing Ramana Maharshi to the Western world as much, you know. And he lives there, you know, in Tiruvannamalai. And you know, he's a real, you know, scholar and a writer, and he's quite extraordinary. And so he has this article about Ramana Maharshi's past lives, and he's writing about it. And he says, you know, so-and-so would have Ganapati Muni, or I can't remember the name, but something like that. It says that Ramana was this, you know, person in the past life, this guru, this sage, or whatever. And people had different ideas, and they presented them, and people think that this is true and everything. But he said Ramana never really agreed. He often did things just to please the devotees. They say, I want to believe you're this. And he said, okay. Then he later said, well, so-and-so wanted me to say I was this because they want to believe I have magical powers or miraculous powers or, you know, special superpowers. And so I was just, you know, I signed my name to it. And later on in some deposition of a lawyer about some dispute over the land there, he said, did you write this? And he said, yes, but the thoughts were this other person's thoughts. The handwriting's mine, but the thoughts were someone else's thoughts. And this is the way Ramana was. So he did not necessarily say that he was, you know, this particular guru or whatever previously in the previous life. So then, in this article, it's brought up that Ramana Maharshi explains it. It's explained how the Yani, or the enlightened sage, is. And what the way it is, like a wall, and you throw like a ball against it, and it bounces off the wall, and it ricochets back. So as you throw the ball, so you get the rebound off the wall. And other teachers said, as you play the instrument, so you hear the tune. So when people came to Ramana Maharshi, what they got out of it was what their own samskaras, which are the habits of past lifetimes. And Ramana explained this. He said that, you know, they asked him about, well, great inventors or people do wonder, you know, extraordinary things. And he says, well, that's because of past habits, samskaras that you carry with you from life to life, actually, and they can reemerge in the next life if you really focus on it. Otherwise, they stay submerged. But various habits are carried over. And he said what those great inventors do is they are able to concentrate their mind and put themselves into a one pointedness where they can immerse themselves in the memory of the knowledge they had previous lives. And then it comes through into this life, and then they can enhance it. And this is why they're able to do extraordinary stuff. Now, I can testify this. This is important. I brought up my previous life as Johannes Brahms because this is what happened in my life. I was able to, when I was young, I was able to hear symphonies on, you know, in my mind. I could compose symphonies in my mind as a child on piano. I sit at the piano and I've had a hard time playing because I was hearing an entire symphonies just right in my mind. I could just compose symphonies in my mind just like that. And I'd just be quiet and I just like, and I try to like play them on the piano. And people say, whoa, you're getting crazy. It's too stormy. I mean, it's too much. Or is it, you're supposed to be playing this little, you know, tune, that little tune that we have in your sheet music. And I said, no, I'm hearing this, you know. I couldn't explain it to them, but you know, I could just compose music in my mind just like that. I was constantly doing so. I was constantly listening to beautiful music in my mind. Okay. Well, these are some scars that I carried over from a previous life. There's no question about it. I know it for a fact. So, what Ron was saying was absolutely true. Absolutely true. And he said that then when you go to see a liberated sage, you, what your samskaras are, what your character is, what that just bounces off the sage automatically. The sage is like a mountain or a wall, just everything bounces off, and then you get that back and you say, wow, you know, this is what the sage is giving me. But it's really, we're just giving it to ourselves. And the sage is just this perfect wall that gives a perfect reflection, like a mirror. It's like we're looking in a mirror and we say, oh, look what I'm seeing in the mirror. And this is what's happening. And they said, if you come with silent mind, peace, silent mind, and your goal is liberation, that's what bounces off the wall, and that's what you get, you see, from liberated sage. So, how to tie this in with what I'm saying? okay, now, this is what I'm saying. What if there is another realm? What if there is another realm? Well, we say, well, how do we get there? Well, spiritual wisdom. It is such that the way we get there will be our desire and how we feel comfortable is what bounces off the wall. So the way we might think, well, we need to travel there in ships or something. So for those who believe that way, that's what will happen. That literally all this stuff just manifests as our own desire. So if we desire ships to manifest to take us to another realm, that's what will manifest, and we'll think, oh, the ships have come for us, and we, you know, take the ships there or something. Whereas if you think differently and say, no, I'll just shift dimension, I'll just shift there through spiritual practice, then that's what will happen. You'll find yourself shifting into that realm. All right. Or there may be all sorts of many different ideas that people have, is this is how we get there, and the realm is it like an enlightened realm? So however you think about getting that realm, that's what manifests to you. So there may be many ways to get to that realm, many ways. We may arrive at all sorts of different ways. Some may see a bridge that they just walk across, you know, they just walk into another realm. Sounds like a stargate or something, right? Or dimensional stargate. Just go right through it. Others want the spaceships or something to go to that realm. And some want, you know, this guru to lead them or what God, you know, whatever. And this is what will happen. I just thought about that. And I understand it now that there may be multiple ways to be based on our desire. Now, I know they always want to depopulate this planet. Well, maybe we'll help them out, you know. Let's help them out and go to another realm and make it easy for them that way. Georgia guides don't say how many people are supposed to do that here. Like 500 million people is the ideal number. That's what's going to happen, they think, you know. Well, that's a lot of depopulation, isn't it? 6.5 billion people would have to be depopulated if that was the case. Wow. And so I'm thinking, okay, what's next? Again, I got that call from a Vietnamese in this morning, and it just right away, a Vietnam War just clicked into my head. I've been thinking about the Vietnam War and talking about it to people recently. Brings back terrible memories. That was, I mean, that was just hell for us. And when it was over, oh man, we thought, you know, time to party. And what happened after 75, right? People did, you know, party time started up. The whole disco thing got underway eventually, and people just partied like there was, you know, no tomorrow. I mean, these are people that felt that they were going to be plunked down in a jungle, you know, with, you know, napalm snipers, and it's just hell. And suddenly the war finally comes to an end. Like, hey, let's just party and party and party. And they just party and party for years and years and years and years. And I don't blame them. You know, it was just, man, it's different than World War II, where everybody rushed down to enlist. It was amazing how patriotic people were at that time. And they couldn't wait to get over there and fight. Same with World War I. They couldn't wait to fight this honorable war. This is like, and Civil War, same thing. It's amazing how times have changed. Whereas we, our generation, we didn't want to go to war at all. I said, what's going on here? I mean, this is a civil war. Let them, you know, sort it out. And, well, we've got to stop the spread of communism and everything like that. But, you know, we hated the war. Most of us did, you know. Even those who went, they didn't like it. You know, they said, hey, it's terrible. You see so many homeless people. Viet Von Vets is just, it scarred them for life so badly. So, anytime you bring up the Vietnam War, that's got my attention big time. And they repeated the same thing they said twice to me. Maybe it's going to be twice as bad, or I don't know what it would, doubly impactful or something. Well, let me tell you, if it's doubly impactful for the United States, what the Vietnam War was, forget it. I mean, there was so much social turmoil in this country. I mean, the animosity and the protests and this division, the generation divide and everything was absolutely horrendous. I am telling you. Older people were the enemy. You know, this was a corporate war, military-industrial establishment war, and they were using young people as cannon fodder for it, and we knew it, and we hated it, and we were absolutely rebelled. And if it's twice as intense as that, you know, forget it. That's pretty much what's being indicated. Some people say this next war is going to last 40 years, which would be twice as long as Vietnam War, so to speak, right? I think was it Nostradamus or something? There's some, you know, I have heard that a war is going to last a long, long time. Maybe that's another indication, you know, of twice, you know, doubly impactful. Because we absolutely were sick and tired of the Vietnam War and the lies and everything about it. We were absolutely, I mean, it was hell. I mean, my life's been hell. First, the Cold War, where your teacher tells you, if a bomb lands, the alarm will sound, and make sure you all get under your desk, okay? We said, oh, okay, teacher, okay, well, can you explain a little to us, teacher? I mean, you know, where's the next bomb going to land, and how is getting under our desk going to help us with the next bomb again? Could you explain that? Now, little Johnny, you know, little Susie, you know, just follow what I'm telling you. This is what the drill. You'll be fine. Don't worry. We've got it all worked out, and you'll be safe. We'll take care of you. Just get under your desk. And we're saying, You know, as you get older, you start thinking, you know. So the Russians drop an atomic bomb in the vicinity. I'm supposed to get underneath my desk. Not sure that's, you know, I'm not really feeling so safe, you know, what the teacher's telling me. So we kind of like had this rift between teachers back. I know I did, because I feel these teachers are not telling me the truth. You know, getting under my desk isn't really going to be good for me. So I'm going to school, and I'm walking to school, I'm thinking, you know, I'm not really safe here at school, and the teacher's going to tell me I have to go to my desk. Heck no, I'm going to run for some better shelter under my desk, you know. Unfortunately, we didn't have a bomb shelter. A lot of people did. I mean, there were bomb shelters under civic buildings all over the place. There were bomb shelters designed to withstand atomic war, because that's what we expected. We expected any day an atomic war to break out. And supposedly the extraterrestrials prevented it. That's what Edgar Mitchell says. And he says he's talked to the top people involved in NORAD and the missile defense system who are in charge of it. And they said, indeed, many, many missile tests were shot down by extraterrestrials. We were very aware of it. The planes, the ships were hovering about our facilities in White Sands of New Mexico, or White Plains, whatever it is. All over the place, the ETs were. We know they were there, and they interfered with a lot of our testing. There's a fact that the highest levels, you know, the government, military, knew about this. And they told, eventually they finally told Edgar Mitchell, and he finally has come out talking about this. So, but then we go from, you know, the Cuban Missile Crisis in 63, which basically we all thought we were going to, World War III was going to start, and we're all going to be annihilated. And then, of course, Kennedy gets shot, which was a false flag probably, you know, to keep us, you know, strongly anti-Soviet Union or something, and we're completely freaked out about that. That must have been in, what, 63 or something like that. Maybe Cuban Missile Crisis was earlier than that, but it's in between 60 and 64. And so we're completely traumatized with that, and then LBJ gets in office and starts, you know, sending troops over to Vietnam, 65, and the Vietnam War starts going. So there you go. You go from the Cold War baby to Vietnam War teenager, you know, young, you know, youth, teenager. And then you get in, then you get into the party era, which was just like, you know, I said, wow, this is too crazy. Forget it. That's going to kill me more than the war. I mean, I think the party time after Vietnam War stopped killed way more people than Vietnam War did. I think it was like 55,000 troops killed, maybe. That doesn't count all the people who were traumatized and committed suicide afterwards over the last, you know, 50 years or whatever. But the people who died from the partying, I mean, we don't even have those numbers. I remember Deborah Harry from Blondie said half of all the people she knew in the music industry or friends died from too much drugs, from too much partying. Half. And the ones that survived almost died. I'll tell you that. Now, I know people that died. My best friend died in high school from too much partying. Because the war hadn't ended yet. They tell you the war, it was 1974 he died. And that was pretty much in 75 they, you know, basically stopped the war. And I think maybe in 74 the draft might have ended or something like that. But we were, you know, we were all still so frightened that we might be, you know, involved in this war, that people were just like trying to cope with this fear. And I get, you know, he just partied. He partied too much. And he invited me to go with him to a party. And I, for some reason, the Holy Spirit told me, turn him down. I turned him down. And on the way back home from that party, he crashed, drove his car off a cliff. And that was it. Closed casket. And that just traumatized me severely, because I really said, my people are dying right and left from the partying. And that went on and just got absolutely crazy. Like they say, if you survived the 60s, the 70s, you know, if you survived the 70s, you know, you weren't there, actually. It's the 70s when people were really, really partying. 60s was a little bit, but no, the 70s, that's when cocaine and everything came into the picture, and people went absolutely nuts. If you survived it, you weren't there. Or if you remember it, you know, you weren't there, whatever. It is true, most people can't even remember the 70s. I was very depressed during the 70s, and I don't really remember much of it, tell you the truth. Just went into deep depression, you know. Just I think the stress, so many angles, the stress was just horrendous here. We just couldn't find shelter, you know. We couldn't find shelter from the stress. There you go. So right now, if the impact is double of that, you know, wow, double impact. No. And it, the way it's shaping up, it looks that way because the animosity and the hard-edgedness is just unbelievable right now. By taking the temperature of the mindset of the world, people are like rabid dogs. Speaking of rabid dogs, I talked to you about that dog that I did this practice. I am now. I am now. I am the now. I am the now. And the dog went suddenly silent when I did that. This barking dog, this ferocious watchdog. Well, I was back there again today, and the dog is barking, 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 and someone else was there is barking. And I suddenly said, hey, wait a minute, let me try this again. The dog came over towards me, he's barking. I tried it again, poof, dog went silent. I said, wow, is this some sort of coincidence, or what's going on here? And as I stood there quietly for a long time, the dog kept barking at other people, but then would look, turn around and look at me, like kind of weird look in its eyes, like what is that? What is that? Like, what is that? It was silent, looking at me, kind of blinking, like, I just kept practicing. I am now. I am now. I am now. I am the now. It was kind of difficult because of the stress of the situation. But it wouldn't say, the dog wouldn't say anything. And then it would look at someone else and then, rah, 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 you know, ferocious. So I said, just doing this practice somehow alters perception. Okay, it alters the dimension of perception. We made perception. Perception, pretension is perception. What we're engaged in here is nothing more than perception, actually, which is no perception reality at all. It's only knowing. But when we do this practice, I am the now. I am the now. Now, we don't, when we're stressed, we don't quite get it, but we got to keep doing it. Somehow this alters perception. It alters this whole realm, which is time, space, process, form. It's just perception, which is make-believe, which is pretension. But it alters it. So the dog, like, couldn't see me clearly enough to bark. I said, what is that? The dog's like, I can't quite figure out what that is. But he saw someone else and just, rah, 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 rah. I see who that is. I'm going to bark at them. So just by doing this practice, somehow this subtly altered perception, and a dog is just, you know, they're very honest. You know, they're just like, they just, it is what it is with a dog. Whereas human people, they might have a different perception too, but they might just going on habit and just say, well, I know what this is, I'll just go on my memory, and they kind of brush it off. Whereas a dog will just, he's just honest and say, wait a minute, I'm not sure about what is that? I don't know if I should bark at this or not. I'm going to be quiet. Now, so there's another funny thing that happened. I went into a store, and then I had to go back to the store, and I put on my hat because it was hot. It's very hot. It's 100 degrees today. It's glaring. So I said, I'm going to put on my hat. So I went back in the store with my hat, but I was practicing this, I am now, I am now, I am now. So I go walk in the store and walking along, and then the store clerk sort of goes, whoa. He started listening. He goes, whoa, you look different. Like that. And then I get up to the checkout, and they say, wow, they're just kind of looking at me like, oh, it's so different. Everybody's like looking at me like, whoa, you were just in here, but you came back, you look so different. And I said, okay, well, it's because of the hat. But then I thought, I mean, what's the big deal? I wear a hat, and everybody's kind of like startled. They're all startled at me. And they said, well, they blamed it on the hat. But I said, wait a minute, maybe I was doing this practice and the way I look to people is changed and they're seeing me differently. And so they're just blaming it on the hat. You say, oh, I know why you look so different. It's because, oh, yeah, it's the hat. See, this is, humans have the ability to rationalize like this, whereas dogs don't rationalize, right? You see, the dog's more honest. It just says, I thought there was a person there to bark, but I don't see any person there right now to bark at. What's going on? The dog looked very perplexed. The look of a very perplexed look on the dog's face. I said, sorry, dog. You know, I'm sorry I'm perplexing you, you know. But then he kind of just shook his head and just wandered off. He says, I don't know what happened there. I thought there was a person there, but apparently not. So how about that? This alters perception. I really feel it does. In doing this practice, I feel this is like, so it's just like fundamentally profound. It's a game, fundamental game changer for us. I am the now. I am the now. Not the personality's the now. That the now is is identity. I am the now. This is what I am. The now is my identity. Now is my identity. Now is identity. And it's not so easy to practice right now. You have to really be relaxed and unhurried and unpressured and do it. When I was with that dog, I suddenly just figured I had to do it real quick and let me try to do it. So it didn't feel like really relaxed and flowing, but it still had the effect, you see. So I recommend doing this. I am now. I am now. Now is identity. It's the only identity there is. There's only now, and I am now. There's only now, and I am now. There's only now, and I am now. And we're not far away from realizing this, really. So keep trying to practice this. This could very well be the key towards some sort of ascension, some sort of shifting to realms, some way of getting what we need. You can't always get what you want, which we might want peace in this world, which it doesn't look like, you know, that is likely. But we might get what we need, which is freedom from the distraction of this terrible storm. So the Holy Spirit again is being, you know, super urgent with me. And it could be that this practice needs to be given out to the world in something related to this, and we need to start practicing it. And it is profound enough, which I believe it literally would enable us to shift realms. This is how powerful this is. It literally can change perception, all perception, for however we want it to be. If we want to see ourselves in some other world, that's where we'll find ourselves. That's what it'll be. You know, it's that powerful. Now this whole world also could be transformed in some way. Yeah, but I don't know if that's the remedy or not. It's possible. It's possible that you see the whole world as this beautiful, peaceful place. Jesus says a vision of Christ will show you this world, but he doesn't rule out going to another world. He didn't rule this out. And Holy Spirit, so it seems to be indicating, we'll see, we'll find out, won't we? It's one or the other. Either we're going to see this world as this unbelievably beautiful way of honoring our creativity, and we'll be absolutely invulnerable here, or we'll go to find ourselves in another realm. But I say this to you, if you find yourself in a dangerous situation, immediately turn to this I am now practice. I am now. I am the now. I am the now. I am the now. I am the now. Do not react to the situation. Just say, I am the now. And I know intellectually we'll freeze up on this. My intellectual part of my mind freezes up on this. But I highly advise this. There's a story about this devotee of a great guru. And this was in the partition of Bangladesh. Muslim is part of the Muslim Hindu problem there, and the Hindus were being slaughtered there. And this one of the great devotees of this guru was walking through Dhaka, and during this time, and he probably shouldn't have been, and suddenly someone started shadowing him, following him, and he got this terrible fear that this person was out to kill him. And this person walked up to him finally and said, "Hi, you know how you do it, like the, you know," and just started walking along with them. And suddenly he shouted and said, "No, you know, do not follow me," or something. And he said the guy was like suddenly like struck dumb, like paralyzed. Just stood there like a stone. And then he just walked on. And then later on, he heard the very place he was walking, there but numerous murders take place there. And he was sure that this guy was going to kill him. And of course, this guru knew about this, saw it. And you know, but what happened? Well, if the guru is able to say, I am now, I am the now, the guru knows that they are the now, that the now is identity. It's the only identity there is. And thus, it is the now expressing here in the world as identity. This is what it is. And they could easily have said something, just a thought of the nowness to that disciple or something there. And this changed perception, totally changed the perception of the situation entirely. And that person who had been, you know, who was going to, you know, attack and kill the devotee, suddenly, I think the devotee must have vanished, is what happened to their perception. So imagine if you're walking along with someone and you're really waiting for an opportunity to get into a dark area or some street where you then you're going to kill them. And suddenly the person you're talking with, walking along with, completely vanishes. They're not there. What are you going to do? You're going to stop. Right? And you're going to look around like this. Like a stone. You're going to be like frozen. Is it? In shock. This person just vanished into thin air like that. I believe that's what happened. I believe that's what happened. The aligning, accepting the now, practicing accepting now changes perception. It absolutely changes perception. We're dealing with fundamental perception here. Now, they say there are people, there's another dimension, it's right here, we just can't see it. Well, afterlife, they say, well, maybe that they're dwelling more in the now, and we're unable to perceive it. Because we don't think we're the now, we think we're time, we think that now extends into time, or that now needs time, so we're just seeing time, space, process, and form, and we're blind to it. As I tell you, I used to see the afterlife when I was young. I used to see all sorts of entities flying and traveling here in the after, and they call them angels or whatever you want to, various other beings, extraterrestrial beings, saintly beings. After I could see all this activity going on, and talk to people about it, and they say, what are you talking about? I don't see anything. I said, well, it's right here, you know. And you could, you know, precognition, I was able to have all these psychic abilities, but because it was more in the now, I was more in the now than the people who have been spending time in this world, where it distracts you from the now, thinking that, you know, that your identity is based on time, space, process, and form instead of the now. Now doesn't need anything. I am the now. I don't need anything. I am now. I don't need anything. I am now. See, this is what's hard to get. We emphasize. I am now. I'm not a moment from now. I am right now. I don't need anything to be added because I'm right here, right now. I'm completely here now. My entire being, my entire identity is right now. It's all right now. It's not segmented out into time, space, process, form in the slightest bit. I am totally here now. And of course, in the 60s, Ram Dass made a book that Be Here Now, which was like very, very, you know, people were trying to calm down from the Vietnam War and the Cold War and the Vietnam War. They were freaked out. And they went into meditation. You know, they said, we've got to find some way to calm down. So they started looking for techniques. You know, a lot of people went in, you know, a lot of people, their parents were using Valium, you know, and a bunch of drugs. And well, alcohol, really tons of alcohol. People were drinking like fish. Our parents, you know, they'd have parties, cocktail hour. I mean, every day you'd have cocktail hour. People would be, you know, wolfing down martinis or just, you know, drinking like fish, getting sloshed every day. They got sloshed every day. I mean, but who didn't? Cold War and Vietnam War. We were worried. And so they said, no, I don't want to take Valium and getting drunk all the time. Maybe I can find this. I heard there's some guru over in India that was teaching how to have peace of mind. He says, om, 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 you know. And so we, you know, we started trying all these techniques to calm down. This is what we really were doing. People, we go to church, they say, well, church isn't calming me down. The priest, you know, is over the sacrament and eat the body of Christ. But it didn't seem to calm us down very much. And they say, well, don't worry, you'll get to heaven when you die. I say, well, I before I want to get to heaven, I don't want to suffer the tortures of the damned here before I get to heaven. So can you at least give me some prayer to calm me down? And they say, well, we don't really, you know, try St. John on the Cross or St. Teresa or something like this. But I said, but you know, people started seeing Ram Maharshi. It's like this person, he's calm. He's at peace. Nothing bothers him. They said, hey, wait a minute. You know, what's his deal? What's his deal? I want to find out about what his deal is. So everybody was the grapevine. There's this huge grapevine about how to calm down. And of course, there's all these drug pushers in the grapevine saying, hey, I've got your magic little pill here. You know, one pill makes you smaller. What makes you taller? One pill makes you small. And the ones that mother give you don't do anything at all. Just go ask Alice when she's, you know, was it 10 feet tall or 3 feet taller? And the White Rabbit by Jefferson Airplane. They're all, everything was about, you know, how can we find peace of mind? We were freaking out. just imagine the freak out that's coming in this world. So there was this combination of all this grapevine, of all this hippie thing about, yeah, you know, these drugs from here, that drug doesn't work, but this one will work. And I got a connection, White Rabbit by Jefferson Airplane, okay. And then there's all the spiritual stuff. Oh, yeah, Ram Dass, you know, I was with Ram Dass, and I was just like, so I found such beautiful peace. Or, you know, everybody was looking for some teacher. You know, the Maharishi, you know, Mahesh Yogi TM. I'm chanting the mantra. I got a mantra from him, or Krishnamurti. I was going to see him in Ojai. And so there's a grapevine about drugs and spirituality. Okay, White Rabbit. One pill makes you larger and one pill makes you small. Is that right? And the ones that Mother gives you don't do anything at all. Right? Go ask Alice when she's 10 feet tall. Okay, I had it there. And if you go chasing rabbits and you know you're going to fall, tell them a hook of smoking caterpillar has given you the call. Call Alice when she was just small. When the men on the chessboard get up and tell you where to go, and you've just had some kind of mushroom and your mind is moving low, go ask Alice. I think she'll know. When logic and proportion have fallen sloppy dead, and the white knight is talking backwards, and the red queen's off with her head, remember what the dormouse said. Feed your head. There's the 60s for you right there. Okay. Come on, man. I think somebody's trying a little too hard there. You know, but what, that's supposed to calm us down? Yeah, that's supposed to bring us peace? I just listen to White Rabbit and go ask the dormouse, you know? Yeah. Feed your head. Go ask the dormouse, feed your head. Well, we were all trying to feed our heads. And, you know, this is going to be twice as impactful right now. Well, you're going to feed your head too much here. Believe me, you're going to feed it too much. And people already are just like, you know, alcohol's made a ferocious comeback right now. It's being advertised to young people like crazy because the alcohol companies realize, you know, the stress, you know, is so severe. The pharmaceutical companies are just pumping people, young people, full of pills like crazy. I mean, these young people are on so many pills now, it's just an epidemic. Because they're trying to calm down, because the world is crazy. And we've had these wars, we have this instability. I mean, this stuff is, people reading the news, reading the internet and stuff, and they're just, I mean, this is freaking people out. So they're looking for peace, they're looking for, you know, looking for peace in all the wrong places. Which is another song, looking for love in all the wrong places. What's that, Eddie Rabbit or something? I don't know. All looking for love. Who did that? Well, I can't know. I can't find this one. Looking for love in all the wrong places. Yeah, well, it's not coming up. That's okay. Because it's pretty obvious that yeah, you're searching in drugs for peace of mind. That's not going to work for you. And I know a lot of young people are just right now. It really, like that. And I say, hey, meditation. They go, yeah, I gotta meditate. You know, it's like, wow. But aren't we fortunate? Because after a lifetime of searching and work here, the Holy Spirit, I've been able to listen to the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit says, try this. You know, this is not the dormouse speaking, you know, this is the Holy Spirit. And so I think the Holy Spirit knows better than the dormouse how to feed our head. And it's saying, try neither nor, try neither nor. I neither reject you, I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. Universe, I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. Cancer, I neither accept you, nor reject you. I got a friend of mine right now, he has to go up and visit his in-law there. They've got cancer, very severe situation. And immediately I sent a prayer out. I said, hey, cancer, I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. I am the now. Now you wonder how gurus can do miracles at a distance. Well, I am the now. I neither accept you nor reject you, Cancer. I can speak to Cancer right here, right now, can't we? I'm now. So I speak to Cancer right now. There's no gap involved at all. And I say, Cancer, you know, I neither accept you nor do I reject you. And you know what? Cancer, two thumbs up, say, right on, right on, right on. Thank you so much. Because it's all our own pretense, isn't it? And honor our creativity within the Cancer, but the suffering of the dynamic of the Cancer, we let that go. But we honor our creativity as it plays out as Cancer, as it plays out as any illness. All illnesses are just our own creativity. Which are doing it because of our continuity fear. We're afraid to stop pretending, otherwise we think we wouldn't have any function. We think pretending is our function. We're so screwed up, we think pretending is our function. So how can we function the way God created us as in reality, you know, where we're just straight, you know, direct knowing. There's no pretending at all. If we think pretending is our function, we're going to be terrified to let that go, right? Obviously. So there's a horrible continuity fear here. I wanted to help people out, you know, with music early on, but it was too insane. It was too insane. You know, I said, music isn't good enough. It's not working. And I was shocked. You know, I thought music was the answer, but it wasn't working. And people had to take more and more drugs and more messed up. Oh my God, it was horrible. I know people that were like, you know, drinking a fifth of vodka or more a day or whatever, just chugging hard liquor. This is how they're living back then, popping pills and smoking weed and just doing everything. Because, you know, they felt that, you know, war, that they're going to go into war tomorrow or something. Right? Brutal. People these days don't realize what it was like. The younger generation has no idea, really. Because there's no draft, there's nothing like that. But they're going to find out, you know, a double impact, and this isn't good for anyone. I tell you, music is not going to do it for you. Nor are video games going to do it for you. Nor is anything going to do it for you except right spiritual practice, which is I've been being the hammer for this for so long now, is only right spiritual practice is going to save you, save anyone. The bottle's not going to save anyone. People drink themselves to death. Now, yeah, I know people have done that. I know that this, they get so freaked out, discouraged, they just say, that's it, I'm just going to drink and drink and drink until I die, that's it. They don't know right spiritual practice. This is the problem. People should look at everything that's happening right now in their lives just a blessing from God, and don't argue and don't get upset about it. This is very important. I've tried to tell people this, they're not listening. Just so whatever happens, thank God, you know, this has helped me out. I went through my email last night, I think, and I there's thousands and thousands of emails, all junk. You know, I deleted almost all of them. I only kept a few emails. My whole email account is most of it's deleted because it was just all junk mail. You know, I get tired of trying to block all these companies. You order something from a company and they never leave you alone the rest of your life. It's hideous. Absolutely hideous. Hate it. Just hate it. And this technology just is such, it's so pathetic, so despicable, actually. The way, you know, we got some idealized hope of the way it could be, but, you know, the way it actually is just despicable. So I just don't do email. You know, I don't even check it. I don't want to read, you know, 50, go through 50 spam. You know, I keep putting spam, but somehow they keep getting around it and keep sending. You know, it's just ridiculous. It's all bots doing this, you know, and I'm supposed to spend my time fighting off robots? No, thank you. Which is the future here on this planet, is humans trying to fend off being controlled by robots? I think I have, like, you know, trillions of better things to do than that. This would be like the bottom of the list of anything I really want to do at all. And I'm supposed to be locked into this? No, I'm not locked into this. I am now. I'm not locked into anything. I am now. There is no prison that can hold me. I am now. I can't ever be locked into prison. I am now. I'm entirely now. This is where I am, is now. And I don't need any place to be because I am now. Right? That supersedes any place at all. I am now. So, this is the last day of the heat wave. Muggy conditions coming up. And then cool, seasonal cool conditions, autumn conditions coming up. And then maybe it gets hot again. I don't know. But I'm going to try to carry this severe diet into the 23rd of September, if I can. It's starting to hit me pretty hard right now. I felt really tired today. Well, you know, drinking half a big bottle. It goes a liter, 2 liters of grapefruit juice. It's a big bottle. Half of that. Drink that. Then a little cup of yogurt, and then a little salad, and that's it. So that's pretty severe. Pretty severe, but every morning I get on the scale, I say, hey, that's pretty nice. I like that. It's going down, which is a good time. I mean, I think by the September 23rd, which as many people feel is D-Day, you know, really a lot of various people from various prophetic backgrounds and stuff is looking at September 23rd as D-Day, as far as, you know, something very important is happening. The urgency of the Holy Spirit's off the charts. Never experienced anything like this. Literally telling me to don't waste time with this. Don't. And if I have gotten those music CDs, I would have like then started listening to them all. Got completely distracted, right? And the Holy Spirit says, you cannot get distracted right now. Absolutely cannot get distracted. And yet these temptations to get distracted keep coming up, don't they? And I asked all the gurus and all those who liberated from the battlefield forever to stand with us right now. Make sure we do not get backslide in any way or get distracted in any way, and stand there like a vast army, you know, defending us and protecting us, you know, from any backsliding. So we keep focused here. We keep focused. The right spiritual practice here is the answer, coming from a veteran of trying to find peace of mind through the Cold War, through the Vietnamese War, and then through the party era, which was crazier than the war, you know. I mean, it was just nuts. I just took refuge from it. I didn't go anywhere. I just dropped all my friends and just sort of went into a monastic cell, like, because it was out of control. That was before AIDS, too, keep in mind. You know, AIDS put a halt on that to some extent. it was crazy. Just out of control times. So I just said, well, I gotta sidestep this. This is gonna ruin my life. Gotta sidestep all this stuff. And I did, and started reading A Course in Miracles. You know, A Course in Miracles enabled me to sidestep all that time. Started in 1978, the summer of 78 is when I started it. And that was a good thing I started it then, because, you know, it from then on it got, you know, very, very, very crazy in the world, in a party sense. And then technology started coming in. So there are ways to bypass stuff, but I think what's coming now in the world, how are we going to bypass this, the intensity of it, if it's double intensity of anything we're used to? Keep in mind that the freak out in the United States during World War I and World War II was negligible. World War I was part, you know, not much at all, and then World War II, it was your patriotic duty, and everyone supported the war 100%. And, you know, if you didn't go to war, the women just wouldn't even look at you. My uncle wouldn't let him go because he was the only, they needed at least one child, one man in the family, so to speak, and had some sort of, I don't know, they insisted that he'd not go, the government. He wanted to, he tried to, he kept trying to sign out, they wouldn't let him know. And you need to stay with your mom and look after the family or something like that. And so it was hell for him, it was absolute hell for him. The women just gave him hell. He's a lifelong bachelor because of it, you know. He really was. Yeah, I think it so traumatized him that he just said, I'm not ever going to marry. They were vicious to him. He couldn't go to any parties, couldn't do any socializing, couldn't do nothing. He said, what are you doing here? You know, what are you, a coward? They'd call out him. They'd make calls to him on the street. They harassed him. They bullied him. The women did. There's no men, hardly any men around. That's why the government said, we need some men around. But they said, well, you know, you're an able-bodied man, and you should be over there. And so you're a terrible coward. What are you, a commie or something? Or, you know, well, they didn't have that word back then so much. So, but what are you, a Nazi or something? They were brutal, just brutal. And he told me about it, you know, and he didn't want to talk about it too much. But so there, the country was united, and boy, the spirit, the patriotic spirit, and we're going to win this war, and off, this is great, and they won, when they won the war, it was fantastic, you know, and then the Korean War was kind of on the down low a little bit, but it's still, you know, still patriotic there. So the Vietnam War is the first time when we felt this massive civil disobedience, generational divide, unpatriotic, you know, conflicts and with authority. I mean, this was the first time that this had really happened, and it was around the whole world was this way, really, in different ways, not as bad maybe as the U.S. And it was just horrible. And if this is going to be twice as bad as this, then you know, hey, going to another realm is the way to go, or you know, somehow seeing the world as a perfect place is the way to go. Don't think you can deal with sex, drugs, and rock and roll. You can't deal with it that way. Guaranteed. You absolutely cannot. You're going to run yourself into the ground. As so many did, you know, during the party here after the Vietnam War, both during and after. You know, they say, hey, I want to get my life back, you know, but I'm so traumatized. How to get my life back? So many people were traumatized, and including all the people who went over to Vietnam. I mean, they were terribly traumatized. They came back here and they said, man, how do I find peace of mind? And so they partied like crazy. In fact, I talked to a friend recently. He said that they went to Mexico, Puerto Vallarta, I think, after the end of the Vietnam War. They were in the Vietnam War. And all him and all his buddies, I mean, they were discharged and they went to Puerto Vallarta and they absolutely partied like there was no tomorrow. And back then they said, you could do anything. You could do anything. Nobody said a word, you know. And he said it was just unbelievable. I mean, we never stopped partying. For quite some time. And those soldiers coming back to the States, that's what they did. That's what they did. And they pulled a lot of people into that, you know. I mean, they just said, man, we want to forget the jungle. We call it Nam. We want to forget Nam. We want to just absolutely, you know, plaster this out of our mind. Now, the World War II vets coming back, they just jumped into the corporate world and they said, you know, let's just work, make money, have a nice suburban house, have four kids, and have martini hour every day. Have martini hour and work days. And then, and then you have parties, social parties on the weekends. Oh, absolutely, that's what we do. So they just drank like crazy. Madmen time, you know? Okay, we're getting closer to the end of this video. So, you know, I have experience. I have a ton of experience here. And I've been trying to find peace of mind. How do you find it, really? And now we're getting to this whole thing about actually changing perception, being able to change perception. Which is the whole fabric of this dream is just, it's all just perception, a dream of perception, actually. Because I am now. I am now. I am now. And I neither accept nor reject the universe. I neither accept the universe nor do I reject it. I neither accept nature nor do I reject it. I neither accept body nor do I reject body. I neither accept sickness nor do I reject it. I neither accept, you know, this, nor do I reject this, and neither nor. These practices are super, super potent. We're talking about something more potent than sitting here and going om, 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 om. Now, maybe for some super practitioner in that tradition or something, that also is tremendously profound, but it doesn't translate well to right here, right now. Remember in the dream of that desert storm, I was able to take refuge in the storm under a modern table. Under a modern table. Okay. So, these saying neither nor, neither nor, neither nor, neither nor. It's very modern. And saying, I am now. That's it. Is quite modern, too. We got the roots of this and be here now. Not be here now. No, I am now. See, being here. Who's being here now? We're not saying be here now. We're saying I am the now. That is what I am. The now is literally what I am. This is quite different. Be here now is still very dualistic, and it didn't work very well. You know, so they had to throw the sex and the drugs and the rock and roll with the be here now and, you know, try to cool out. Hey, cool out, man. You're ruining my groove here, you know. This is, everybody was trying to get into their thing, you know. My space, my thing. I'm trying to get peace, man. And you're ruining my thing here. Come on. You're stepping on my trip. You're throwing a bummer on my trip here, man. Come on. You know, don't throw a bummer on my trip. I mean, they're trying to get into peace of mind. Don't disturb what I'm my efforts here. And so we all respect one another's efforts. Okay, you know, you're trying to find peace. I am too. And there's a sort of this feeling of oneness among us because we're all searching for peace. We were all searching for some way to calm down. You know, and it's like our parents couldn't help us. What's wrong with little Susie, little Johnny? What's the matter with them? They're so active and nervous, you know. And, well, yeah, I mean, our teacher said that the atomic bomb could be dropped on us today. And he said, don't worry, get underneath the desk and you'll be okay. Somehow I still feel a little nervous today, you know. I feel a little nervous from school. What's the matter with school? I don't know. Well, you know. I feel a little scared. The bomb's going to fall, and I got to go to the desk. Oh, no, don't worry, you know. You'll be all right, you know. Do what the teacher tells you to do, and then when they go back to the martini hour, you know. They come home, and they start drinking, you know. The bar, they all had, you know, wet bars. What the hell's a wet bar? Yeah, it's like, what? I go into these houses, and all these, like, this totally stocked bars. Like, they're walking into a bar. And they say they're all pouring each other drinks and talking and socializing and, you know, pound down about four or five, you know, hard drinks, and then go home and sleep. Drive home. They all drove home then. As for DUIs, was a big deal. Everybody drove drunk back then. Not everybody, but a whole lot of people. They socialized and got completely sloshed. You know, they didn't drink. They drank hard alcohol. Martinis, Manhattans. You know, they knew all those drinks, and they got completely sloshed. And then they'd drive home. Of course, there are tons of accidents. All the time. And back then, though, nothing really much happened to you with the DUI. They didn't have blood alcohol testing or anything like that now. You know, just like, no, don't do it again, you know. Be careful when you drive. You know, limit your drinks. You know. Yeah, sure, okay, officer. They didn't just have a few beers back then, believe me. Just look at the bars, the wet bars they had. Of course, they thought they're smoking too. They're very sophisticated people. So our parents were smoking and drinking. My parents didn't, my parents didn't drink at all. Especially my dad, nor did they smoke. They nor did they socialize. They didn't do any of that stuff. They said they're more trying spiritual, like find the spiritual path. You know, try to find it spiritually. So that's where I was able to keep focusing on that. So, yeah. This has been a pretty entertaining video for me to make, for sure, and probably has been for you to watch also. Stream of consciousness, but just this is just what's happening right now. This is what's happening right now, planet Earth, where you're walking, you're breathing, right here on the same planet, you're touching the same soil as I'm touching here. All this stuff is happening right here, right now, today. This is time and space, process and form of belief, and this messes up our whole understanding, you know, a whole relational situation. It really does. But occasionally you can take a look back and realize everything that's happening on the planet, it's all happening to us simultaneously. You know, whatever anyone's doing on this planet right now, it's the same time. It's right now for everybody. It's right now for everybody. It's already right now for everybody. It's already right now for everyone. This is a fact, isn't it? And we see this and say, whoa, this is a completely different way of looking at things. Holy God, I know what I could do with this. You know, it's just like, we keep thinking distance. No, I'm saying this, and then, you know, you're hearing it later, but you're distant, far distant, so, you know, what you're doing is not the same time that, you know, what I'm doing. But literally everything that's taking place in the world right now, to chewing gum, to walking, you know, to sitting down, whatever, insects flying here is the exact same now as some insect flying over in Hawaii. And speaking of Hawaii, this is very interesting. The eagle always tells me, take refuge in Hawaii. That's a nice place for you. Well, I just met somebody I hadn't seen for a while. They retired, and I said, hello, how you doing? He said, oh, I just got back from Hawaii. I said, oh, how was it? He said, it was terrible. We had to leave. Couldn't wait to get out of there. I said, what? He said, it was brutally hot and muggy. We just walk outside, you're just like in a shower. This is horrible. I said, what happened? Well, the trade winds got blocked. Huh? I said, yeah, there's some hurricane off here, and it just got stalled or whatever, and it just completely blocked the winds. And he said, the place was absolutely miserable. And they said, it came back here to a heat wave, you know. But he said, no, it was horrible. We didn't. And I just heard someone who went back there, his family lives there, and they called him and said, it's horrible here right now. Terrible. So Hawaii is not this perfect place by any means. And they talked to somebody else that was there, and they talked to mosquitoes. Oh, the mosquitoes were horrible. They're just biting, you know. You go, oh, it's just terrible. You know, I said, oh, really? Mosquitoes, super hot, muggy. It doesn't sound like paradise to me. And plus, if you walk around the beach at night, you're going to get mugged. So no, Hawaii is no paradise. Not at all. That's not our goal here, is Hawaii. And then someone else talking about the coconuts falling on the golfers' heads, you know. I mean, but the tourism board keeps playing, yeah, Hawaii, I've got to go to Hawaii, got to go to Hawaii, got to go to Hawaii. Yeah, no, I haven't been to Hawaii since 1975. Most, a lot of people I know go every single year, sometimes twice a year, every year, they go to Hawaii. That's just completely standard procedure here. But no, don't get, unfortunately, you know, I love the islands. I lived there for 2 years when I was young. But back then it was pretty cool. You know, there wasn't the racism and belligerency and all this kind of stuff. It wasn't happening then. But the mosquitoes were definitely happening. And the insects and everything like that. But yeah. So we're looking for something even better than Hawaii. Way better than Hawaii. I am now. I am not being here now. I am the now. See, I am not being here now. I am the now. I am the now in which everything is being. Okay, I am the now in which everything is happening. I am that now. I am that now. And the video is probably going to stop pretty soon. Yes, it is. Oh, yes, it is. So, hey, what a time we've had here tonight. 9/11/15, the double jubilee of 9/11. And we're not defeated, are we? We're not without tools, are we? We're not crushed, are we? We're wise, we're very wise. Okay, but we're not, you know, desperate and frantic and without any help and feeling like don't know where to turn and all this kind of feeling. No, we're not that way at all. We're saying we know exactly where to turn. Turn to right spiritual practice. Neither nor I am now. I am the now. And I neither reject the universe, nor do I accept it. I neither accept the universe, nor do I reject it. I neither accept humanity, nor do I accept it. I neither accept civilization, nor do I reject it. I neither accept suffering, nor do I... I neither accept suffering, nor do I reject it. I neither accept suffering, nor do I reject it.